Because when people like you, they tend to see the best in you and what you represent. It's really simple. If I like the guy, all he's jumping around tells me he's enthusiastic. If I don't like him, he's an idiot. If I like the woman, she's kind. If I don't like her, she's weak. We make those decisions in the first 2 seconds of clapping our eyes on someone, even when they look, whether they're looking at us or not. And so that's one reason. And the second reason is, for some strange reason, when we like people, we unconsciously look for reasons to say yes to them. And when we don't like them, we look for reasons to say no to them. Your fight or flight saying, get out of there, go, 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 move out. So these are really simple things. And we're into about the first second and a half of connecting with somebody. Also, the third reason why it's nice that people like each other, especially at work, well, at home too, is it's very hard to have fun with people you don't like. You know, it takes one jerk in a group to make the day drag on forever. You go home miserable, you come back to work in a bad mood the next day, and your work doesn't go very well. So it's really great when people actually get on with each other. So what it is that do you think that we respond to when we see someone for the first time? Anybody? Body language, you said what?
Appearance.
Appearance, yeah, what else? This section here is not doing very well. You have to start yelling a bit, aren't there? You can make it up, I don't care. Darn it, who said that? Because usually nobody gets it, so I usually say, it's on the slide, and they go, smile. I say, and the slide's in order. It is your attitude at the beginning of an encounter more than anything else that determines your success or failure, because your attitude not only drives your behavior, it drives other people's behavior. I need a volunteer on the stage. Don't put your hand up, just get here, and I'll give you a bribe for doing whatever you're doing. Thanks. Okay. Oh, please don't. Yeah, please don't call me sir, because that puts a barrier between people. No. That's good. Thank you. Just relax and then look at all these faces for a second. So your attitude is actually made up of, in face-to-face communication, 55% your body language, about 35% your voice tone, and about 10% the words you use. And so, I'll actually prove it to you. Can you all stand up for a second? You can just enjoy this. Just hang around and watch. Okay. Put your arms out sideways. With the forefinger and thumb of your right hand, make a circle. The other right hand. That's right. Bend your right arm at the elbow. Turn it towards your face, the circle towards your face. Good, good, good. And place it against your chin. Great. Great. This is your chin for all of those. Did you get it right? Oh, man, good.
I was copying everybody else.
OK, please sit down. That's how strong your body language is. But now what about attitude? Because an attitude is your voice tone, your body language, and the words you use. And the crazy thing is that I think this is hysterical with texting these days. If you say to somebody, you drive me crazy on a text, they don't know whether you're angry with them, you make them laugh, or you want to marry them or fire them. I don't know, you drive me crazy. We don't know what it is. But when you're connecting with other people, it's very important, because actors, this is what actors do, the three Vs, the vocal, the verbal, and the visual, all say the same thing. You know, using exaggerated body language and voice tone to say, you drive me, don't do it until I tell you how to do it. You drive me crazy. Say it as if you're happy to these guys and convince them with your body language. Really convince them, so get in the mood there.
You drive me crazy.
That's great, that's beautiful. Now say it as if you're unbelievably sad. Get in the mood first, get the body going.
You drive me crazy.
That's quite a heartbreaker actually, isn't that? Okay. Now I want you
to.
Keep working me. Yeah, okay. Now I want you to say it as if you're, get in the mood first, as if you're unbelievably excited.
You drive me crazy.
No, one more. That wasn't completely convincing. Make them believe you. Make this guy believe that you drive him crazy.
You drive me crazy.
That's right. Okay. Now, that you'd have the fun bit. Now, will you all stand up, please? I want you to say, all of you, I want you to say it in a very convincing way. I want you to say, you drive me crazy. As if you're in agony. Go.
I
You don't look like you're in much agony. Say it as if you're unbelievably sad. All right, we'll see if we can get these guys going now. Now, I want you to say it this time, and put everything you've got into it, as if you just found out you'd won $134 million on the lottery. Finally, he woke up. Okay, thank you, please sit down. Thank you, have a book. Thank you very much, thank you. All right, so the first thing we respond to is attitude. The second thing is eye contact and a smile. All of this stuff happens, except for the common ground bit, in about the first 2 seconds of connecting with someone. It sets the tone for what's happening. Eye contact and a smile are really interesting. In our culture, eye contact says trust is in the air. You know what it's like, you talk to someone and they don't look at you. It's incredibly weird. But not everybody can do eye contact. And there are good reasons why not. But so simply, all I say is that when somebody approaches you, just notice what color their eyes are. That's enough eye contact. Just have a look. I did some work for a big hotel chain based in Chicago. And they said, we know we're having problems. Our people are not very good at eye contact. So all you've got to do is tell them that you're doing a survey to see if you serve more blue-eyed or brown-eyed customers. So someone walks up to the reception, hi, how are you doing? Blue. That's it. They did enough eye contact. One of the very large motor companies, car companies in this country, after they heard the speech, they put it on their customer service forms for the service department. They just said, customer's name, and there was a little box, customer's eye color. It obliged them to actually look at the customer's eyes. So the thing is, notice the color of the eyes of the people. Just for a split second, it's enough to start to build trust. If you have kids, we have a generation and a half of kids today who are not great at eye contact, and it's going to cost them dearly one of these days. So if you have a kid, bribe them. Say, come home from school tomorrow and tell me the color of the eyes of every teacher that you spoke to, and I'll give you $10. All right? Well, it used to be that. I'll give you a second flat screen for your room. Because they're not great at doing it. So eye contact, just a fleeting bit of eye contact, is enough to start building trust. A smile is also very important. A smile in our culture sends the unconscious signal that that person is happy and confident. That's exactly what it sends. Again, look at the staff here as they walk around. Hopefully they walk around with a fairly natural looking smile. Now, not everyone has a natural smile. I don't. But I spent 25 years as a fashion photographer. I shot all over the world. I shot for Vogue, I shot for Cosmo, I shot for all these. And I work with a lot of professional models. And not all professional models have a natural smile, but they have a trick that they do, which I will share with you now, when they come onto the set, if it's the kind of shot where they need to be smiling. And what happens is they come on the set, and they actually use the English word great in bursts of three. Great, great, great. Great, great, great. Great, great, great. Because when you say the word great properly, it makes your eyes smile too, it warms them up. So what happened would be that that you can be the photographer, right? Because you just pretend to be the photographer. You don't have to do much else. The backdrop is here, and the model comes on, and the photographer goes, great, great, great. And the model goes, great, great, great. And the hairdresser goes, great, great, great. And the model goes, great, great, great. And the stylist goes, great. Before you know it, everyone's eyes are smiling, and they look like they are happy. So I'm going to give you all, for those of you, some of you have a great smile, some don't. I'm going to give you all a great, great smile now with a really quick exercise that takes 5 seconds now, and there's a second part for later on. Can you stand up, please? That's right. Leaping up in the air with energy, that's right. All right. Just turn to the person next to you or behind you. I want you all facing somebody. That means you have to turn a bit. Okay. That's right. That's all the person behind you. There's people, or you can be three of you, but face each other so your hearts are pointing at each other. Now, this is a two-part exercise. This is a two-part exercise. What I want you to do right now, for 10 seconds only, in the stupidest voices you can find, is to go great, 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 over and over, just for 10 seconds, really loud and really stupid. It's important that you feel stupid. Go. Great, great, great. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Please sit down. That's part one of the exercise. That's part one of the exercise. Part two is tonight. When you go back to your room, I want you to go into the bathroom. Or when you get home, I want you to go into the bathroom, lock the door behind you, and put your face about 3 inches from the mirror and look at yourself. You know that feeling. You still there? Right. And then I want you to do this exercise over again for 30 seconds. I want you to yell, great, 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 at yourself in the mirror for 30 seconds. Don't worry about people knocking on the door saying, hey, can I come and join you in there? And then if you do it, and if you felt stupid or whatever, and or had fun now, and if you feel stupid tonight, then tomorrow, as somebody approaches you, you see it's a trigger and an anchor, all you need to do under your breath is say to yourself, great, 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 as you approach somebody, and you'll remember all this ridiculousness, and I come to you, great, 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 hi, I'm Nick, nice to meet you. And Callie says, my, that guy is happy and confident. That's all you've got to do. It seems like a small thing, it really isn't, because a good smile makes you look good. The next thing is open body language. This is pretty simple. Basically, as open body language and closed body language, open body language exposes your heart. Basically, all you need to do is point your heart at somebody just for a brief moment with it uncovered, and it sends a signal to the fight or flight response that you're not going to harm them. Incidentally, a quick word about eye contact and smiling. Too much of it is incredibly creepy. We're talking about just a very quick, just a look and back again. Otherwise, it's like those people that shake your hand, you know, and they don't let go. Oh, man, you're not thinking about anything now except let go of my hand. So open body language exposes the heart. It's a very simple thing. Do it for a little while. I need another volunteer, please. Just get up here. Don't put your hand up or anything. Here we go. Oh, I need two chairs. Can we find two? No, there's one thing we don't have in here. It's chairs. Okay. Well, we'll if we sit on the edge of the stage here, can you see us? Let's sit on the steps here. I'm Nick.
Dave.
Nice to meet you, Dave. Oh, there we are. There's one chair. Oh, Callie, thank you so much. We need one more, and we'll give him back to you in a second. Thanks. You can come and sit on the side of the stage if you want. Come and sit here. Nice and comfortable. Show your leadership skills. There you go. There you go. Have a seat, David. All right, so what? And you're all welcome to sit on the stage. It's happened tons of times. People come and sit there. I won't pick on you. I'll pick on everybody else, but I won't pick on you if you sit on the stage. If you say to somebody, I like you, what do you mean? Yeah, I know you say, I know I like you because I just said that, but what do you mean? What do you actually mean?
You seem like a great guy.
He needs bailing out. You look like a great guy. Yeah, what else? What? What a connection. I feel comfortable with you. Yeah, well, you're an old pro now. You've been up there. Okay. What you actually mean is I am like you. The great truth about face-to-face communication, as I said at the beginning, is that people like themselves. When you say I like you, I am like you. We've got stuff in common. Maybe we've got the same taste in holidays, or pets, or food, or work, or crossword puzzles, I don't know. But we tend to like people who are like us. But what do we do from a body language point of view when we're with someone that we get along with? Well, it's simple. Our bodies actually tend to naturally, please stay like you are, David. Our bodies tend to naturally, see, by the way, at the beginning I said talk in the positive. I didn't say don't move. I said stay as you are. And we'll talk in a minute about that. So stay as you are, absolutely. Our bodies, ever since we've been 10 months old, we tend to synchronize with the people that we grow up with, the people around us. And people who still have their natural people skills intact will naturally tend to sit the same way as the people that are with. If I was talking to you, like now, I might move and just talk to you like that. If I was going to talk to the gentleman in the green shirt, I'd just do this because we just... And you, this, because it's natural. We've been doing it our whole lives. This is very natural. So if you still have your natural, that was it, by the way. Thank you. Come and have a book, and I'll keep talking. Here, come and grab a book. Thanks, David.
Thank you.
How hard was that? Thank you, Kali. I'm going to give you a book later for all the hard work you've given me. Thank you. Thanks a lot. So we tend to naturally synchronize. But you know, it's like as we grow up, a lot of people get their natural abilities knocked out of them, like curiosity, one of the greatest human attributes in the world, by, you know, sometimes well-meaning people and sometimes not so well-meaning people. And they get their people skills knocked out of them, you know, with kids who ask too many questions, you know. Why you ask too many questions, shut up. Well, you know, they only realize that's what God invented red wine for. It's for the parents. That's okay, sweetheart. You keep asking me questions like that. And so I'm going to ask you, I'm going to do an exercise in synchronizing right now. Will you all stand up, please? Be really great if you feel like moving into the aisles, and let's use the whole room. It's like speaking up and standing out. You rule this place, so saunter or swagger into the aisles, because I want you to pair up with somebody. That's right. And you can relax now, you know, you can relax and glow, 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 glow. Okay, can you come on stage for a second? Yeah, I'm going to demonstrate with this willing volunteer here who I just asked to come on stage. Hi, I'm Nick.
Hi, Sasha.
Okay, this is what's going to happen. In the groups, the person standing closest to that wall is A. Will you put up your hand if you're A? That's right. Everybody has to put a hand up so we're not mistaken here. All right. The person standing next to that is B. There's nothing personal in this. It makes it easier. Okay. Here's what's going to happen. Actually, you better go that side. Thank you. They'll stay there. Here's what's going to happen. For the next 90 seconds, A and B are going to have a conversation. You can talk about anything you like, being here, tomorrow. You can sell them something. It doesn't matter. For the first 30 seconds, B, that's me, is going to synchronize the overall body language of A. Now, A, if you're an A, I'm talking to you now, give them something to work with. Don't just stand there. This is an exercise. And look, it might be creepy now, but it won't be afterwards when you go out and psych the world out. All right. So what I want you to do, so A, give them something to work with, like sit down, stand up, lean, fold your arms. You know, not all the time, but just keep changing. It's like a sort of gymnastic thing. So they can just get in the habit of following you. After 30 seconds, I am going to whistle. You're right over there? Okay, I'm going to whistle and say break synchronization. And then B does something completely different. Like if A is standing like that, B might stand like that. And as soon as I do, you change. We keep changing until we lose the person. Just break it. You'll see what happens in your head. Then after another 30 seconds, I'm going to say synchronize again. All right, we got it? B does what A does, B doesn't do, then B does do. Now, a quick word to all of you Bs. A quick word to everybody. Put up your hand if you're a B. Quick word to you Bs. If A does this and you do this, you're an idiot. If A's talking like this and you're listening like this, you're still an idiot. It's the overall body language, standing like the guy down there or the guy over here or you. It's just the little bits. Now, this is natural. We've been doing it since we were babies. All right. So that's all you had to do. That's all you have to do. Thank you. Go and choose the book if you want. Yep, okay. Thank you. Okay, so 90 seconds starting now. What I'd like you to do right now is one of the greatest things that great leaders do, CEOs do, managers do, great people who are really great at connecting with other people is they can normally find common ground with somebody in 30 seconds. They can pick up on something, maybe something they're wearing, maybe on an accent, or ask them a question that allows them to find common ground. Because does anybody here have twins in the family? Put your hand up if you have twins in the family. Right, put your hands right up high. I know it's not to be enthusiastic about, but because I do too. Okay, so you've both got twins in the family. You can put it down there, right? So you'd have something to talk about. You know, whether they're grandchildren or whatever. You've got something in common. Who liked I'm sorry about this. Who liked the movie Titanic? Okay. Well, they're brave guys now. Hey, listen, I just watched Sweet November and bawled for an hour upstairs. It's pathetic. All right. But Okay, but the thing, my point is, you've got stuff in common. The moment you find common ground, in all my books I call them Me Too moments until lately when that seems to be a hashtag going around, but which is really a pity, and I got there first, but because I used to say that Oprah Winfrey, she finds Me Too moments with her audience. She'll say something, I've got a problem with this, and 15 million people go, oh my God, Me Too. And so the bond is there. So with the person you're with, or even better, make a group with the people behind you, get four of you. I'm going to give you a minute to find common ground. You can do it. If you can do it in fours, it's even better. Just start chatting and look for stuff. And it can't be we're all wearing shirts or pants. Go for it. Okay, thank you. Please sit down. Please sit down. Great, somebody just found his cousin. Okay. Anybody find out anything like totally freaky? Anybody find anything really freaky or weird or exciting? Oh, well. Yes, what?
We all work for the same company.
No! You all work for the same company. And all the guys are wearing shirts, right? Oh, you've got. But you know what I'm talking about. That's why I cut it off. You get the idea. When you can find common ground, and I know you're in a fairly privileged position here at this show because you're all in the same business. You're all coming from a very similar background. But let's talk for a second about story speak. But by the way, one of the things I meant to mention about first impressions, by far the best way to get rapport with somebody is something I call assuming rapport. When you assume rapport, you just talk to the person as if they're a long-lost cousin or somebody you already know. Sometimes you have to introduce yourself. I realize that at a trade show, but generally, assuming rapport. For example, I came on the stage and I just assumed rapport with you all. I just started talking to you like we were talking this morning. And just so assuming rapport with people in your life and when you go out, removing the formality between you and just assume rapport. Just start talking to people. I know you can't do it everywhere. And obviously, you can't do it on a sales call. But assuming rapport, you can do it to some extent here when people wander up. You just wander up and start talking to them like you've already known them. Then you can do the formalities afterwards. And also something else about this business about making first impressions very quickly. I have people all the time who say, when people get to know me, they really like me. Well, you know what, that's great for your family and your next door neighbor and anybody else who can't escape you. But when it comes to business or to dating or whatever, it just doesn't cut it. We have to adjust our stuff so that they will like us. I'd like to talk quickly a little bit about the irresistible power of story speak, because essentially, we spend, the stats from Nielsen just came out. The average North American, and I count myself in there, spends 10 hours and 39 minutes every day listening to stories. Reading them or listening to them or involved with stories, devouring stories with the words they use. Whether it's reading about them, whether it's playing video games, whether it's reading the headlines, whether it's texting somebody, what did you do last night? Oh, I went to the movies. They're all stories. And so story speak, when you can get, in other words, when we feed people, if we can feed them stories, we can get anything. Because the strongest force that anybody has is imagination. Your imagination is the strongest power anybody has. It's infinitely stronger than willpower. That's why diets don't work. You pit a puny willpower up against a crazy imagination, the imagination wins every time. So with story speak, you can program your imagination and other people's imagination in a respectful, good way. But a couple of the things are talking in the positive. There are only six things that any of us do on a day-to-day basis apart from body functions and urges. Five of them are we go into the world, we have experiences through our senses. We see, we hear, we have physical sensation, smell and taste. And the only other thing we do is that we put our experiences into words. We put them into words and we explain them to ourselves. And then we explain them to other people. That's what you're going to be doing tomorrow. That's what you're going to be doing after this. You're just taking your experiences and explaining them to other people. That's what's happening in the convention center over there. People are going to come in, you're going to explain. And first it was explained to you and then to them. But here's what's interesting. As we go into the world and we have, and on the quality of those, the explanations we make to ourselves, we make every single decision in our life, everything. So as your experiences become your words become thoughts. Your thoughts become ideas become actions, your actions become habits, your habits starts to be your personality, and your personality drives your destiny. It's called making sense of the world. And we start it off by putting our experiences into words. And what happens by the time by the time we reach puberty, 10, but puberty is 6 or something these days, I don't quite understand. But by the time we've reached about 10 years old, we have learned to do this without thinking. We've learned to what we call think without thinking, but it's actually explaining our experiences to ourselves. And what happens is that some people get a positive way of explaining their experiences, and some people get a negative way of explaining them. But we need both. Some people are good at spotting problems, some are good at spotting opportunities. But we explain our experiences in words, and we need to explain them in the positive. We need to speak in the positive and not in the negative. Otherwise, it's like me walking into McDonald's and saying, all right, I don't want a coffee, I don't want a salad, and I don't want a donut. They say, what the hell do you want? So get into the habit of putting I have a quick story. I live on a farm in Canada, and my neighbor just two lines over has a horse farm. And he came to me and said, look, I'm going crazy. People are coming out at the weekends, and they're feeding my horses. So I put a sign up saying, do not feed the horses. When I put the sign up, it got worse. He said, now people who hadn't even thought about feeding the horses saw the sign, said, let's feed the horses. So then I put a sign up saying, please do not feed the horses. He said, it got worse. I said, well, of course it did. Now they think you're polite, you won't mind. He said, what can I do? I said, put this on your sign, see what happens. And if you go, I invite you, go by there today, north of Toronto. The sign reads, we only eat apples and carrots. That's the visual you need to put into your communication with other people. And just quickly, that's a really, really simple thing. But we are in the habits of talking negative. This is the most powerful thing you can do in any communication. It's called I-COLA, and it's a whole section of it in the book. Basically, I-COLA stands for it's kind of like a. And in business, this is fantastic. If you see, when we go out into the world, with everyone in this room, you're all a unique part of the idea delivery system. That's your job. You deliver good ideas to market, to other people. That's everything in life is about good ideas to other people, whether you're trying to get married or go on holiday or whatever. And the easiest way to stick something into somebody else's head is through an image. When Warren Buffett was asked how he enjoys his job, because he's one of the best in North America on doing this, in the world, he said, I tap dance to work. We get it. Visual people can see it. Auditory people can hear it. Kinesthetic people can hear the old feet going there. Muhammad Ali, when he was Cassius Clay, said, I'm going to float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. We remember those images. The chicken of the sea, these guys took a fish that no one would buy, a gray tuna, repackaged it and called it chicken of the sea. It's kind of like chicken of the sea, and suddenly it sold. The guys there staring into this boat, this is a company I did some work for in New York, 2,000 engineers, and they had developed a software program that they then, the president of the company says, I want you now to go out and evangelize C3. So I had with them for a day to figure out how they're going to do that. I said, okay, let's do an I-COLA. C3 is kind of like ah. And this went on and on and on for about 2 hours, and eventually somebody guy came up and said, you know, in a way, it's kind of like rowing around in a glass-bottom boat with your client. We can all look down at the same time and see what's going on. So once you have that, then you can start from there. When Warren Buffett was asked to describe the deficit, he said, it's kind of like a farm with a big mortgage. Every year you sell some of the farm to pay the mortgage, soon you've got a big mortgage and no farm. Because you have complicated concepts in what you do. When you can make those complicated concepts simple, people get them. I know that engineers talking to engineers, but even so, and the pitfall is there because I had I got to get a move on. It was a woman who couldn't get a job, and she was in accounts receivable. And she said, I said, give me an I-COLA. I am kind of like, I guess I'm kind of like a pitbull. I said, why? She said, because I'm really loyal, and once I get my teeth into something, I never let go. I said, next time you go on an interview, if they say what else, or you say, can I say something? I said, yeah. You know, I'm kind of like a pit bull. Once I get my teeth into something, I never let go, and I'm fiercely loyal. She hadn't got a job for 10 months. She got the next job she went to. It's really simple, sticking I-colas in people's heads. Let's see if I can quickly get through how to appear socially smarter than you really are. Wear great clothes. When you walk into a room, head for the middle. Move more slowly than you normally would. Use the 3-second rule and ask talk show questions. Wear great clothes because more people will take you seriously. It doesn't mean you have to have phenomenal clothes, but if you look at in business, your clothing goes between your authority and your approachability. Somewhere in between there is where you land, because you need your authority, because you actually have to look, not at a trade show like this because everybody knows you, but you have to look like you know what you're talking about. I don't want my bank manager in a thong and a baseball cap. I have to know that my bank manager knows what they're doing. But also, I don't want my bank manager dressed up like an undertaker. So somewhere in between there, the clothes matter. Head for the middle. If you head for the middle of a room of people you don't know, the perception is that you're popular. Popular people hang out in the middle. Wallflowers hang out around the outside. Except, where else can you go today? You've got to lean against something. Move more slowly as you walk into the middle of the room than you would normally, because people who move slightly more slowly come across as sexy. Now, guys, it does not follow that the slower you walk, the sexier you are. The slower you walk, the bigger the idiot you are. The 3-second rule is at an event like this, which is called a close field, where the expectation is that you will socialize, the 3-second rule means that I always advise that if you're at an event, do it 7 times. You're going to walk up to somebody you don't know, and the way you're going to do it is when you decide to do it, it's the very first person you look at, as long as it's someone you don't already know, and you just walk up to them, you walk up, and as you approach, you're going, great, 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 under your voice, and you just say, hi, how are you? It's nice that you're here, blah, 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 that's all. It's about getting to know new people. And asking talk show questions means that, because we don't teach our kids how to start conversations at school. We tell them they're going to be good listeners. Well, you know, you've got something going on so you can listen in the first place. So you can respond in the first place. Talk show questions are basically a statement followed by an open question. When I did this on the Today Show, the host said, okay, Nick, so fine. What do you mean? I said, okay, I could say, I hear New York's a fantastic place, statement. If I only had 4 hours, what should I see? Then it's over to the other person to do the speaking. How do you keep people talking? Louder. That's a clarifying question. Yeah, but what else? Oh, you're doing it over here. Physical feedback and international grunts. There is nothing worse for a human being to talk to somebody who doesn't move. Your fight or flight response is get out of there fast as you can. Physical feedback is just... and international grunts, we know what those are? These work in almost any language. And so, my time is up. I want to thank you for listening to me. It's been amazing to be here, and I wish I had more time because we could talk. Oh, I could talk a lot more. Thank you so much, and have a great show. Oh, wait. Remember this. That's all you've got to remember. Glow, assume rapport, and say great, great, great. Thank you.
Great, 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 great.